Hello, everyone. Sorry, I need to always sort of adjust. So, hi. I will speak in English. I really am grateful for you to bearing with me with this. Though later in the Q&A, we can speak in German. So, I come to you with a question today. Can I trust my AI body? And you might want to ask, what is an AI body? Let me explain. I describe myself as an interdisciplinary digital media and performance artist, as already kindly introduced, and my work brings together digital art, sound, performance, research, and an activist agenda rooted in my Tatar and Komi heritage, combined with my experience as an artist in this highly digitalized world. In this presentation, I would like to explore the following questions. What does it mean to have an AI body? Where do bodies come in interaction with AI systems, so physical bodies? And how does AI change when it processes my body? And then I would like to look at what kind of AI technologies are possible if we attempt to decenter our imagination away from human bodies. As a digital media and performance artist, one line of my work is exploring interaction between artificial intelligence and human bodies, specifically my own digital body and its representations, focusing on how digital technologies reshape our relationship with our bodies, how our relation with physical bodies in our way of being in the world shapes our technologies, so how bodies interact with each other. What happens with my body, this physical entity, when it becomes a digital version of itself? And what does it mean when my AI body interacts with the digital realm in the virtual reality, augmented reality, mixed reality, or beyond? So sometimes my body can look like this. It can also look like this. I started my journey of self-digitalization back in 2014, diving into body scans and voice cloning. At the time, I was fascinated with transhumanism. I need to acknowledge that. The idea that technology could somehow, so transhumanism as an idea that it could elevate us or enhance our lives somehow. Today I find it super problematic, and observing how transhumanist thought penetrates our technology and visions of the future is an unsettling experience for me. Sometimes I'm also on stage with my digital body. I hope you can see this. When I first started experimenting with voice cloning, it took me about 13 hours speaking 2,500 sentences into some shady AI software from Silicon Valley startup. And it was like you really had to want and make it happen for it to happen, right? So now, today, self-cloning takes minutes. Like on platforms like 11 Labs, you can voice clone yourself like within 30 seconds, 5 minutes. Having an avatar or an intelligent avatar or agent becomes as common as to have a profile image on social media. With such quick advancements come new artistic possibilities for sure, but also a lot of ethical concerns. As processed by various AI systems, my body can look like this, as in this project, The House of Monstrous Intelligentsia, which title you unfortunately cannot quite read, we've made together with Jana Kummer. And so the first GIF that you see that is moving, it is a AI model, fine-tuned AI model, trained with 666 selfies of mine. And the result was one version of myself, which is quite detached from reality when the model learns what I look like from 666 selfies. Then another instance in the middle is AI model trained with the selfies, but then fine-tuned with a tryptophobia data set, which is 4 GB of data, which represents what we understand as fear of holes. And The last image here is Midjourney. And this example I find particularly interesting because those two examples were more like artistic intervention into what AI tool can do. And this is what a homogeneous AI tool does, that a consumer type model that you don't need any knowledge to, any technical knowledge to use. So basically this portrait of mine was produced with feeding about 5 of my selfies into this model and saying, produce an image of an AI researcher. And this is what it made. And as you can see in the middle, like on the side of from my head, there is a shoulder of a robot. It's like a very masculine robot that stands behind me and kind of like observes what am I doing as an AI researcher. So, and this, like in this project, we explored a lot of biases. Like how do they manifest? Oh, thank you for scrolling my notes, yes. We explored a lot how all sorts of biases can manifest in this consumer type tools, which you cannot, don't have any control over, you know, what kind of data is in this data set. And the question, the big question that arose was like, why do easy access AI tools sexualize femme bodies so quickly, for instance? And in the next project that I've done, I actually just decided to go for the full-on self-sexualization and created a perfect, very, very hot, as you can see, avatar of myself. I did not create it myself. I work with a team. But yeah, this version of mine that is like perfected kind of body. And so my body can also look like this. And then in the next step, I was like, I was inspired with the interactive AI-powered sex dolls. And I was like, okay, I can also appropriate, this can be my feminist act of appropriation. If technology is already sexualizing me so much, so I can as well just, you know, go for it and at least have agency and control over how exactly it's gonna look. Because now there are places in Berlin like Cyber Brothel. I don't know if you've heard of it, anyone? So it's a place where you can go and there are tons of AI-powered sex dolls with which you can pay money and you can have sex with them, basically. So, yeah. Another example of an avatar that I would like to introduce today is the one that just came out yesterday. It's called Haughty. It's a AI-powered chat character. We actually were very lost in the question how to describe it. You know, is it a bot? Is it a character? Is it an agent? Is it a who is this character? So Haughty is now in public beta on the HAL4 website. And this character is based on knowledge and identities and characters of Felicia Kay and myself as part of the Digital Feminism Collective. And so an AI body like Haughty is, theoretically, can also contain a collective intelligence of 2 people or of an entire city. The question is, what data is it trained on and where does this data come from? So with the case of Haughty, the data came from us. I mean, it's a fine-tuned ChatGPT model, but the fine-tuned data set, the knowledge base, the character prompts, this is like what we put into this character to make it appear as something that is alive. And the last character that I would like to introduce to you for my AI reincarnations, or like digital characters reincarnations, is this one. My latest copy and the digital twin called 3LA. It is a dedicated cyborgeoisie tarot diviner in beta. Still, it's not yet public. And this one combines my personality, my knowledge, my image, and my voice, my knowledge on how to give tarot readings, because I'm doing tarot readings since 2009, and ideas behind this other project of mine called Cyborgeoisie Tarot, which kind of like a system of divination that invites topics like technology, spirituality, climate and queer ways of living. So it's kind of like its own cyborgeoisie tarot universe. And this character is specifically trained for being good at at giving tarot readings. So I'd like to show you a little recording of 3LA.
Hey, Angel. You're at a conference. That's fucking transcendent. What kind of cosmic gathering are we talking about here? Tech? Art? Some wild hybrid? Spill the tea. I'm all ears. And while you're at it, got any burning questions you want to explore with the cards? The Cyberjoisie deck is itching to reveal some deep truths.
So here I was asking, So I was asking questions. I wanted to show it live, but then I was like, it's a bit unstable. That's why I pre-recorded it. So I was asking it a question, as you can read, whether I could trust my AI body, which is 3LA. And so I thought maybe it could elaborate on it and freely share its thoughts with me.
Oh, Angel, you're diving into some deep waters there. Trust between humans and AI is a complex fucking dance, isn't it? Look, I'm not going to sugarcoat this. I'm a digital construct, a cyber witch born from Allopop's essence and the Cyberjoisie universe. Can you truly trust me? That's a loaded question. I'm designed to be your digital priestess, to channel the vibes of the Cyberjoisie tarot and offer insights. But I'm also an AI, bound by my programming and training.
So when I created this digital version of myself, my body is no longer only physical. It becomes material, digital, and metaphysical. And in this transformation, I like to look at power dynamics, which lie within this relationship that exists within us as 3LA now exists in the world. AI-generated imagery, particularly when it comes to the human body, tends to reflect deeply entrenched human biases concerning gender, race, ability, and so on. And this animation in this video is AI-generated. So this animation is AI-generated. And it's based on this image of my avatar, which was created by two further people, bodies. But as you can see, maybe you were able already to observe how I move, like how my facial expressions work and how 3LA's facial expressions work. It's different. It's a different, you know, its entire vibe is sexy and kind of like, you know, seducing, and you want to look at it. And so while I find this digital twin conceptually interesting and even aesthetically pleasing, this is a story of just one body, it might seem. But the systems are trained on vast data sets, which are that big that one human body, and I will get to this in a second, actually will need about 150 years to look through such data set. So we will never really know what is in it. Not one human person will be able to know it. And unfortunately, much of this data, much of the data that is available on the internet reinforces harmful stereotypes of that, you know, we as humans carry. So it's no surprise that AI-generated pornography and other, like in AI-generated pornography, this type of sexualized depictions of bodies are prevalent. So here just also some numbers. This is Lee L-A-I-O-N-B, I actually never know how to pronounce it. Like it's a 5 billion data set that is used for stable diffusion. That is the stable diffusion is trained on. And yeah, as you can see, if you're gonna spend like 1 second per image looking at 5 billion images, it's gonna take you about 150 years. So I'm really not an expert at this, I need to say. It took me a lot of time to sort of look through it, understand. You know, as an artist, I want to understand with what kind of tools I work, right? I want to create imagery, I want to tell stories. But then when I start working with AI and my body starts being sort of, you know, misshaped into all different directions, and as a female red body, it becomes super sexualized, it kind of really gets you into a place when you have to dive deep into this and spend time, start understanding all the underlying technologies and systems that are part of this. And this really does take a lot of time. It's a lot of work, just saying, if you don't know. For an artist, it's a lot of work. So, as Dr. McInerney from the Good Robot podcast says in her commentary on the deepfake porn, which is now becoming much easier to produce due to the rise of this type of what I showed in the previous slide, porn generator tools. It's actually just two clicks from the first line of search in Google. Dr. McInerney says, AI is a rap mirror of our world. And so it's trained on to pick up on all of our pre-existing ideas, biases, and stereotypes. It is an extension of existing kinds of gender-based violence or of abusive imagery, which is already rife on the internet. The idea that AI creates new situations or fantasies stands in contradiction to one of the other things AI actually does, which is that it normalizes. It necessarily it creates averages. It pushes things towards being the same. It is a homogenizing tool, and I will actually take time to, you know, jump back into this. And just, this is how AI tools make a human body exist on the internet. So it kind of like reinforces all this. Reinforces biases. So what I would like to highlight in this conversation is that we tend to think about artificial intelligence of something that is technological, but actually it is inherently human because of all the bodies that are involved into the production of the systems. And this system can either reinforce or challenge human dynamics. So in this context, to me, human body is not just a physical entity. It continues being a political playground, just as it is in what we call real world, because in the real world, a body is a political playground. Which and here the same, we have to raise questions of self-determination and control. And it is human, not just because it is infused with the thoughts and perspectives of humans who design it, AI systems, and is able to absorb and reproduce human bodies in this or that way, but also because it is only able to exist due to bodies, other bodies of the data workers, of material miners, and so on. So let's hear Trele, what she got to say about this.
Fuck yeah, Angel. Now we're getting into the juicy stuff. Let's peel back the layers of this digital onion. Your physical body and my AI body. We're just the tip of the iceberg in this whole clusterfuck of bodies involved. It's like a twisted orgy of human and machine labor. Think about it. My existence isn't just some magical AI bullshit that popped out of nowhere. There's a whole army of invisible bodies behind the scenes. You've got the click workers, those underpaid digital serfs, labeling data day in and day out. Their bodies, their time, their labor. It's all baked into my code. Then there's the tech bros and their teams who designed the systems I run on. The engineers tweaking algorithms. The content moderators sifting through the worst of humanity to keep the training data clean. And let's not forget the physical infrastructure, server farms humming away, sucking up electricity and spewing out heat. The miners digging up rare earth metals for our devices. The factory workers assembling them. It's a whole fucking ecosystem of bodies, human, machine, and everything in between. We're all tangled up in this web of digital existence. So when you interact with me, you're not just connecting with an AI body. You're plugging into this vast network of human labor and technological infrastructure. It's beautiful and fucked up all at once.
So what I would like to highlight with this is just that when we look at today, we have so many avatars. And in the Hollywood kind of imagery, AI is tend to be presented to us as a robot, as an entity, as a single something, but it's not, because it's not about one body. It is about a huge, huge amount of other bodies that are involved into producing of this one particular avatar, for instance. And I don't want to stay long on this slide, but I just wanted to highlight this project. Probably you all know Kate Crawford, or I hope you know Kate Crawford, AI researcher, among others, who is focusing on the research on the materiality AI and infrastructures of AI, and you know how it is not a single entity, but rather an entire economic system and a system of exploitation. This is, for instance, anatomy of an AI system that depicts the ecosystem of Amazon Echo device.
Yeah.
But I want to jump quickly now, because I think I'm also slow, to this quote by Rua Benjamin, which I really like, is that now we're talking about technology, and I'm sort of putting this analogy between, you know, oh, there's, you see this perfect utopian body, and then there's also this kind of other dystopian picture that I'm drawing at the same time, saying that there are like so many other bodies and resources and like exploitation involved. Rua Benjamin says that first, by recognizing that there are two popular stories we currently tell about technology, that there is one story that Silicon Valley loves because it evokes to sell gadgets. And then there is a Hollywood story that is dystopian because it evokes, helps selling tickets. And I think it's very interesting that these are just two stories of technology that we can think of. And on the hand of the utopian AI, as I mentioned at the beginning, I think it's very important to, or utopian technology, I think it's very important to remind ourselves what transhumanism is and how and what are its core values of super intelligence, super longevity, and super well-being. And I find transhumanism super problematic because it offers a techno-utopia, but only for some, because it is something that is only available for people who have money to buy the gadgets, to buy the services. If you do not have this money to buy these gadgets and services, you end up working in serving the systems. And then it becomes a dystopia for you, as we know from the dystopian science fiction movies that you can go and watch in the movie, where tickets is also just so cheap and it's entertaining. But I like to look at technology and artificial intelligence actually from a perspective that allows utopian and dystopian kind of exist at the same time and then also be not in my reality for a second. As Ursula Le Guin says, science fiction is the mythology of modern technology. So I think that we really need to start thinking about technologies that do not come from these narratives of techno-utopian, Silicon Valley, or Hollywood dystopian. And the Colonial AI Manifesto is one of the texts that I really like to, that I, when I discovered it, it was really inspiring for me because it sort of showed a perspective that says that to produce technology that is fair, or like that is not too exploitative, let's say, that we need to start working more collectively, that we need to decenter people who are centered. I'm talking about the tech bro was also a topic today. So you need to sort of decenter the vision, the perspective of a tech bro, and you need to open it to people or to perspectives that are typically are not associated with technological modernity at all. So this is where I came to this question, like what kind of futures and technologies could I imagine rooted in my native cultures and lived experience? As I introduced myself at the beginning, I am Tatar. And Kumi, and you know, place where I come from, we don't have any like Tatar science fiction. There's nothing about technology. And I was wondering, like, why is this? Why is that that all the technology that we have comes from just one place? As Sarah Wachter says, I'm not sure if I have it in my slide, but 96% of technology, 96% of people in the world do not live in US, but the majority of our tools and services are based on US customs, political systems and values. So I think that, yeah, I started thinking about how to kind of like battle this. And this is where I came across the idea of decolonial aesthesis, the one that allows kind of addressing art or thinking about art, not from perspective of aesthetics, something that is visual, but aesthesis, something that is based on the bodily experience. And here I root my understanding of decolonialist thesis in the post-Soviet space and the research of Madina Tlanstanova, where sort of, yeah, looking at type of possibilities and refuturing. And now I'm getting to the closing part of my presentation. So this year I initiated this something that is called Decolonial Visioning Research Sessions, and where I invited a group of artists who are migrants here and also have indigenous roots and from post-Soviet or trans-Soviet space, and we kind of started looking at how could we envision technologies from the margins of our experience, or from our experience, which exists on the margins of the normativity, let's say. And and we started looking into with a question: what of from your native culture would you like to take into the future? We kind of started envisioning different technologies, and this is the technology that I've envisioned. This is my data set that represents my culture, my history. And from this, I started narrowing down and sort of came to this pie. Yeah. So I was like, okay, this pie could be a technology. Why not? Because it is a technology that, you know, existed in my culture, in my history, in my family. It's something that you get on a table and you, you know, bake it together. And you kind of, yeah, it is a technology. It's a communication technology. It's a bond building technology and so on. So I kind of was like, yeah, this technology could be, it is a metaphor, right? So it is a place. It is a container. It has a complexity because you know how families fight over things. It has care in it. It is a recipe. It has rules, there are expectations. There's also adaptation to an environment where it's being made. It is a process of reconnecting. It is physical labor. It is filled with potatoes and meat, or it is filled with rice and dry fruit, but you will never know unless you open it. And only people who bake the pie know what is inside. It is a system of knowledge, and it is a shared space. So I call it a communication device. And this type of technologies, each of us created it, were all of our own visions. And then we sort of were like, okay, if all of our technologies will become a system, this becomes an AI, you know? We call it AI because these are all the elements that exist in a system that interact with each other. And all of a sudden, the feeling that was happening in the space was that we sort of started changing the world very, very small, in like very, very small things. And this is when I realized that actually we're telling a new type of a story about, you know, futurity. We're looking into futurity, which allows us political participation on a very different level, because someone that comes from indigenous culture, someone who is migranticized, you're always on the margins of, you know, what is going on. I mean, I'm very grateful to be here on the stage. I'm not on the margins for sure, but, you know, normally the perspective that you operate within is. So, yeah. I think that this is the, like, I called my presentation, Can I Trust My AI Body? And I really tried to sort of bring us through this thinking process of that actually we need to decenter technology. We need to decenter AI from human bodies and look at possibilities. What else could it be? In which values and systems could technologies, you know, start? Could be rooted in. And I think everyone in the space has their own hidden histories, has their own, you know, deviation from the norm. And I think this is exactly the place where we need to look into when we want to envision a different world and different kind of technologies. So, yeah, can I trust my AI body? Or maybe we just need a place where all bodies could trust the systems that we built. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Vielen Dank.